The key word was flexibility. I did not realize just how much. So, all right, if you would take your songbooks, grab a songbook and turn to page 234. As I said before, these are not going to be normal setup for a service. We're going to do a song, and then we'll do the special, and then we'll bring Brother Ken right up. He's kind of twisted my arm and said, "That's what I need," and I said, "I'm glad to give it." All right, well, you have that 234. If you would please stand, and I'm going to ask Brother Don if he would open us up in prayer tonight.
All right, let's pray. Father, we thank you for the opportunity to gather together. We thank you for the gospel that brings us all in this place. We pray for your blessing on the service. May the word of God touch our hearts and guide our minds. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Wonderful Words of Life, 234.
Wonderful words of love. Sweet.
go ahead and dismiss our teachers out and our children, as many as like to go. You can go out the back door with them and they will teach them. And while Brother Ken is plugging up, let me ask the two pastors I know that are here to stand up and introduce yourself and your church. You know, this is free advertising. I'm going to charge you a penny.
Okay, so I'm Don Johnson from Grace Baptist Church in Wyoming.
Pastor Jim Jansen from Capital City Baptist Church, Victoria.
You know, be sure you're friendly and shake your hand and shake hands with those you don't know. And thank the Lord. I really appreciate you coming and making the distance. That was an hour and... hour and something. That was a nice trip. We appreciate it. Thank you so much. And brother, I'll get out your way.
promises.
You know, I've done this several times, so excuse me. I keep losing my Bible here this week. I'm blaming it on him.
I've got broad shoulders, so I can take it. All right, take your Bible, Psalm 91. And we're going to sing verse 2. For you who were not here when we did this, I neglected to do it last night. We sing, I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and fortress. Drop out the word my. And then I lost my place. My God, and then parenthetically, my God again, in Him will I trust. And then repeat that phrase, my God, in Him will I trust. Would you play it through once for us, just the first time? All right, let's try it together. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and fortress. My God, in Him will I trust. My God, in Him will I... Watch it now. I will say of... He is my refuge and fortress, my God, in Him will I trust. My God, in Him will I trust. Not bad. Some of you for the first time, let's stand together, do it one more time, and then we'll get into our study for the evening. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and fortress. My God, in Him will I trust. My God, in Him will I trust. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and fortress. my God, in Him will I trust. My God, in Him will I trust. Can you say amen to that?
Amen.
You may be seated. And let me get out my thingamajiggy to hold my whatchamacallit so it doesn't go you know where. I have really appreciated the spirit in the meetings. We weren't sure what to expect. I have not sensed any sense of hostility. You laugh, but when you do this in a Christian school, I guarantee you there's hostility on the part of some, because I am attacking something that they like and they don't like it. I remember I was in one school chapel in a large school in Montana, and I happened to mention Amy Grant in a negative way. Well, I've done that here. There's not much positive you can say about her as far as truly serving the Lord. It's all entertainment. And I'll tell you, some of those kids came unglued. You could have said more nasty things about the Lord Jesus that would not have offended them than to say something about a contemporary Christian performer.
That's right.
Well, tonight we're... before I go any further, last night we were talking about the fact, one of the arguments to defend Christian rock is that it's an alternative to secular rock. Remember that? Well, let's take a look here and see. Do you want to take this down the aisle so folks in the back can see?
You trying to get me hurt?
Yeah, Jonathan, would you do that? Jonathan can do that. He's small and
I don't mind.
And he's not as frail as you. And you can do this one here. This is a two-sided thing. Sacred Warrior Classics. And over here we've got this group. Wouldn't you like your daughter to date one of those characters? I had a whole lot more stuff, and the problem is that we had a problem with the motorhome, our older motorhome, and we had a leak, and everything got flooded, and all my materials, almost, these are wrinkled, but they got kind of messed up. Just the cover of this one, and this one here is Newsweek magazine. Christian entertainment makes a joyful noise. Hot concerts, big books, new movies, Jesus Rocks is the title of the feature articles in there. When you understand what rock and roll is, that is extremely offensive and sacrilegious at best and blasphemous at worst. I have a copy here of the World Magazine, and the main article here is CCM. It's an interview with Michael W. Smith. And let's see here, where is I? It's here somewhere. I have it all marked up. I should be able to find it real easy. But you know how it goes. Here, I have the thing turned. Here we go. Salt or sugar? That's what World Magazine titles this article. Salt or sugar? Folks, we're to be the sugar of the world, right? To make everybody sweet and lovely and all the rest of it, right? We're to be the salt of the earth. And when you put salt in a wound, it hurts, but it heals. Jesus said, if the salt has lost its savor, wherewith shall it be salted? We're not to be sugar. We're to be the salt. Anyway, in this article, I want to read just a few of the terms that they use. It is a sweet night for the $500 million genre that bases its entire marketing strategy on an objective Christian. At this year's ceremony, purple hair, platform shoes, snakeskin vinyl overshadowed, Southern Gospel Sunday suits, and Mr. Goodman's bubble brown hair, we are here to honor some of the men and women who have made gospel and contemporary Christian music relevant. They are speaking the language of this generation, not there to glorify the Lord. Over here, they speak about marketing executives. Mr. Card's latest project is an album distributed by Word based on the book of Hebrews. One of the marketing people said, get that phrase, marketing people said, is there any way we can do this so people don't know it's about Hebrews? Marketplace, sell records, make money, good business, a definable marketing niche in mainstream society, industry biggies, secular number one Latin single, CCM consumers, sell records, bottom line figures, whose job it is, for profit. We're ratings driven. If we are not successful from a rating standpoint, we are out of business. And over and over and over again, they use terms like business and industry. Folks, not one of the terms used in this article has anything to do whatsoever with ministry. The contemporary Christian music business is a multi-million dollar, almost now a billion dollar a year industry. Where's the ministry? And yet they say, well, we're going to worship God with that. We're going to touch on that tonight. So I wanted to just kind of, I didn't want to bring those for nothing. I knew you would enjoy seeing, oh, that's my favorite guy. No, I know better than that. An area I mentioned last night that nobody that I have ever heard has touched on is the problem with contemporary Christian music versus the doctrine of biblical separation. Now, the purpose of separation is to maintain a difference between light and darkness, both physically as well as spiritually. Now, you know, the two most dangerous times to drive a car are dawn and dusk. At dawn, the light is beginning to dispel the darkness, and at dusk, the darkness is overtaking the light, and everything's kind of muddled, and it's very difficult to see, and it's a very dangerous time. You have to be extra careful. When you try to mix light and darkness, you have trouble. And so, take your Bibles, please, and turn to Genesis chapter 1. Well, I have it here on the screen. We don't maybe need to take the time to turn, but you can write it down. In Genesis 1:4, God saw the light that it was good, and God divided the light from the darkness. I want you to notice that word divided. More about that in a second. In Leviticus chapter 20, I would like you to turn there, because there's a section there that's right before these verses. In Leviticus chapter 20, and verse 22, which comes before verse 24, by the way. Ye shall therefore keep all my statutes and all my judgments and do them. Folks, the Bible was not given so we can learn facts and personalities and dates and all those kinds of things. The Bible was given that we might live it and put it into practice and do it. So he says, you shall therefore keep all my statutes and do them, so that the land whither I bring you to dwell therein spew you not out. Revelation, because you're neither hot nor cold, God says, I will vomit you, I will spew thee out of my mouth. Jump down a few, verse 23, and ye shall not walk in the manners of the nations which I cast out before you. For they committed all these things, and therefore I abhor them. In other words, folks, God is saying here, he wants his people, he expects his people, and has a right to expect us to be different from the world as far as its activities, its actions, and its philosophy of life. We're to be different. But I have said unto you, verse 24, ye shall inherit their land. And notice the last part of the verse, I am the Lord your God, which have separated you from other people. Ye shall therefore put difference between clean beasts and unclean, and between clean fowls, unclean fowls, and clean. Ye shall not make your souls abominable, etc. Notice, which I have separated on you as unclean. Now, God's making a distinction there as far as dietary things are concerned. Some things were considered unclean, and under the Old Testament law, you weren't to eat them. Remember Peter, when the Lord set down the net before him, the sheet with the bacon and lettuce and tomato sandwiches and grilled ham and cheese and all that good stuff. He said, God said, rise here. Peter said, Lord, I'm a Jew. That's dirty stuff. I don't eat that. It's unclean. And God said three times, what I put before you, buddy, don't you call it unclean. All that was to prepare him to minister to a Gentile to whom he had never ministered before. And the Jews consider the Gentiles as dogs. So he says in verse 24, I've separated you from other people. And then in verse 26, you shall be holy unto me, for I, the Lord, am holy, and have severed you from other people, that ye should be mine. Now, notice the word divided in Genesis 1:4, separated, verse 24, and severed in verse 26. What is interesting, and this is where the beauty of the English language comes in, all three of those words come from the same Hebrew word. All three of them come from the same Hebrew word. Separated, divided, and severed. Ezekiel 42 and verse 20. I didn't write that one down, but I've got it right here, so let me read it for you. Ezekiel 42. I'm not used to using PowerPoint a whole lot. 42 and verse 20. He measured it, they're talking about the temple. He measured it by the four sides. It had a wall round about 500 reeds long and 500 broad. Notice, to make a separation between the sanctuary and the profane place. To separate between the holy and the profane. So there we have the purpose of separation. But then there's the importance of the practice of separation. In 2 Corinthians 6:17, come out from among them and be separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing. We've already looked at the immorality. I was going to say the moral issue, but the immorality of rock music, what it is, where it came from. And whether you put the word Christian in front of it and change the lyrics, that doesn't change the music. And that's what it's all about. 2 Corinthians 6:17, come out from among them and be ye separate. It's not a suggestion of God, it is a command of God. And then Romans 12:9, Paul said, abhor that which is evil, cleave to that which is good. Now, the word abhor is the idea of despise and detest. Have no part of that which is evil, but cleave, cling to, literally as though your life depended upon it, to that which is good. Now, that presupposes that you have the spiritual maturity to know the difference and the discernment to know the difference between what's evil and what is good. And I'll tell you what, folks, we're living in an age, I guess Canada is not a whole lot different than the States, where men, politicians, and other people are calling evil good and good evil. Somehow we who are traditional when it comes to one man and one woman in marriage, somehow we're the ones who are the weirdos because now we want to have transgender and same-sex marriages, which is an abomination to the Lord. Now, the vast majority of our populations, your country and mine, folks, are not in favor of that. Don't practice that. It's a very small minority, but you know, the squeaky wheel gets the oil, and they've got a lot of squeak and a lot of noise. And you have to understand, folks, there's no such thing as transgender. We now have a Supreme Court justice in my country, a woman who doesn't know what a woman is. How is she going to be qualified to make decisions at the highest level in our land if she doesn't know what she is? I can tell her how to find out, but I'm not going to go into that here. All right, 1 Thessalonians 5:21 again. Hold fast to that which is good. That's why we old-fashioned, fundamental, Bible-believing, independent Baptist churches are holding fast to these old things, because they're good things. Now, everything in the past is not good. All of our traditions are not necessarily good, and traditions are not necessarily set in stone, and you can't defend them necessarily from a biblical perspective. Some of them are good, some of them ought to let them go. Traditions like what color your Christmas tree is every year, you know? Those are non-essential types of things. But we need to hold fast to that which is good. Folks, we need to hold fast to good, godly music in our churches. And I'll tell you, the two areas where the devil gets, the number one area where the devil gets in the fastest is through music. Well, we want to have a little bit more upbeat music. Remember we talked about upbeat? Upbeat, backbeat, rock beat, African beat, syncopation, all the same thing. We want to have a little more modern music. Well, there's modern music. I gave Mrs. Miner here a copy of 32 brand new songs. They're new. I ain't never been published before. They're ones that I wrote music for. I didn't write all the lyrics for them, but that in a literal sense is contemporary Christian music, but it's not CCM. Hold fast to that which is good. And in Proverbs 4:23 and 23:7, as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. Matthew 12:34, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. Think about that verse. Out of the abundance of the heart, folks, everything emanates. Musically, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth singeth. When there's no change, when a person comes out of a rock culture, supposedly, and they come to know Christ as their personal Savior, as Stryper claims to have done, but I do not believe that that is the case, there's no change. They dress the same. Their music is still the... they maybe have some sort of a... maybe a slight religious flavor to it, but folks, it's not biblical music. And nothing has changed. Why? Because the heart hasn't changed. Could the Bible be more clear? If any man be in Christ, he not will be, he is a new creature. Old things are gone. All things are, and here's where you have the process of spiritual growth, all things are become new. You don't become a mature Christian in 5 minutes. Sometimes these cold, great soul winning churches, they want people to be as mature in 10 hours as they took them 30 years to reach. And there's that that need for spiritual growth. The power of the scriptures. Would someone look up, please, Leviticus chapter 8? Who'll do that? Do I see a hand? Right here, Leviticus 8:10-11. And Leviticus 11:44-47, another volunteer. Thank you, sir. Okay, who has Leviticus 10:8-11? Still looking it up. Leviticus 11:44. Here we go. This is Leviticus 10, verses 8 to 11.
And the Lord spake unto Aaron, saying, do not drink wine or strong drink, thou nor thy sons with thee, when ye go into the tabernacle of the congregation, lest ye die. It shall be a statute forever throughout your generations, and that ye may put difference between holy and unholy, and between unclean and clean, and that ye may teach the children of Israel all the statutes which the Lord hath spoken unto them by the hand of Moses.
Wonderful. Let's all turn, please. Pastor, you have a verse, 11:44.
Can you want through 44 through 47?
Yes, sir, please.
For I am the Lord your God. Ye shall therefore sanctify yourselves, and ye shall be holy. For I am holy. Neither shall ye defile yourselves with any manner of creeping thing that creeps upon the earth. For I am the Lord that bringeth you up out of the land of Egypt to be your God. Ye shall therefore be holy, for I am holy. For this is the law of the beast, and of the fowl, and of every living creature that moveth in the waters, and of every creature that creepeth upon the earth, to make a difference between the unclean and the clean, and between the beast that may be eaten and the beast that may not be eaten.
Again, there's a principle of maintaining that distinction between the holy and the unholy, the clean and the unclean. Let me ask you to turn now, please, to Ezekiel 44. Ezekiel 44 and verse 23. And we read, and they shall teach my people. Now the they is a reference to the priesthood. They shall teach my people the difference between the holy and the profane, and cause them to discern between the clean and the unclean. Folks, I really don't get any pleasure out of speaking on the subject of music, though I have to tell you, because there's such a good spirit here, I'm actually enjoying it. But why do I do this? Why do I spend hundreds and hundreds of hours researching and studying the subject in order to be able to teach others that we might be able to help them to discern? Now, if we go back and compare chapter 22 and verse 26, the Bible says, her priests have violated my law. They have profaned my holy things. They have put no difference between the holy and the profane. Neither have they showed difference between the unclean and the clean, and have hid their eyes from my Sabbaths, and I am profaned among them. In other words, they were not even doing what they were supposed to teach.
Right.
You can't teach what you don't know. You know, and God says, listen, this is what you guys are supposed to be doing, but you're not doing it yourselves. You have failed. And I will tell you this different, and I say this as kindly, but I say it without apology. A pastor who does not teach his people to discern between the holy and the unholy in various areas has failed his people and has failed the Lord. Haggai chapter 2. You may say, what in the world does this have to do with music? Well, hang in there with me. My name is Lynch, after all. And it doesn't deal with music per se, but again, there's a principle here. And that's what we're trying to do, apply biblical principles. Haggai chapter... I'm in Habakkuk. Haggai. Here we are. Haggai is a small book. It's easy to get mixed up. You turn one page, you done went past it. Haggai chapter 2, verses 12 and 13. If thus saith the Lord of hosts, ask now the priest concerning the law, saying, verse 12, if one bear holy flesh in the skirt of his garment, and with his skirt do touch bread or pottage or wine or oil or any meat, shall it be holy? And the priest answered and said, no. Then said Haggai, if one that is unclean by a dead body touch any of these, shall it be unclean? And they said, it shall be unclean. Now, the idea here is that the priest had to go through a ceremonial process of cleansing. And if in the process between he went through that process and he gets to the temple, he touches anything like a loaf of bread or wine or pottage or anything, he automatically became unclean, had to go all the way back and start all over again. And so he says, now, when it touches the dead body, is it unclean? I say it shall be unclean. The principle here, folks, is simply this. The clean is defiled by the dirty. The dirty is not cleaned by the clean.
Right.
I didn't prepare this here, but I would normally take two glasses like this, filled half with water, and the one glass I'd have a bunch of mud and dirty stuff in there, and I would ask people, now, if I take the dirty water and pour it into this, what happens? What do I have? I got a glass of dirty water. But if I reverse the process, shouldn't the reverse happen? If I have a half a glass of dirty water and I pour the glass of clean water, shouldn't the dirty water become automatically clean? Well, it becomes a little less dirty, but it's still dirty. Now, folks, what's happening here is we talk about Christian music. And we have maybe some good lyrics, and there are, sometimes it's right out of the King James Bible. But then we set it to a musical style that is unholy. What we have done is we have defiled the text. You see, music, the musical style and the text need to marry. And again, I'll go back to Holy, 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 because it's a great example. It's not a lively hymn. It's not one that's going to make you jump up and wave a hanky like a Pentecostal or a Southern Baptist, an independent Southern Baptist, and say, glory to God. But it's a hymn on the holiness of God, which is a somber thought. To realize when we enter the prayer closet, we enter into the presence of, yes, the Almighty, but we also enter the presence of a holy, sinless, sin-hating God. That's somber. And the music of that hymn so beautifully supports the textual aspect of that. And so what we're saying here is simply that we oftentimes have music that maybe has a good text to it or good lyrics, but the music defiles it. The music contradicts it. And let me tell you something else. You have these contemporary churches, and I've heard some people say, well, the preaching's really good, but the music stinks. You know what? The stinky music stinks up the sermon. Can I put it that way? People are not going to grow from preaching that has been compromised by the wrong kind of music that has fed the flesh. And if I think about it, I'll tell you about an incident that happened with me in Alaska several years ago. All right, 1 Corinthians 5 and Galatians 5, both of them tell us a little leaven leaveneth the whole lump. It doesn't take a lot of leaven to leaven the whole lump. Romans 12, 2. I'm not going to take time to go back to Leviticus 18, but Romans 12, 2, Romans 12, 1 and 2, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable unto God, which is your unreasonable, reasonable service, and be not conformed to this world. Folks, that is in the imperative. That is a command. And the word conform there means to fashion or shape one thing so that it looks like or resembles another. And this is one of the key verses in this whole discussion of contemporary Christian music, so-called, is that I believe that is not only wrong, I believe CCM is sin, if for no other reason, and we've looked at a lot of reasons, because it violates Romans 12, 2. It is, in fact, a conformity to the world. That's the way it started. Now, let me show you an example, and how do I get it to play? Is it moving?
It is moving.
Come on. Okay. Hang on a second. I got to... Yeah. Let me... How do I do that? I got to go back here and do this over here and get this little thing over here on that. Ooh. No, no, no. I want the volume.
I turned it up on the TV. I don't know if that'll help.
Come on. Come on, baby. Come on. There you go. I hope that's not too loud. Hello?
It's not moving yet.
Oh, here we go. Got to hit that. Something's wrong because it showed a whole, the whole, all the lights and everything like that. Now it doesn't want to stop. All right. I don't know what went wrong on that. I picked that because it showed all the flashing lights, the screaming crowd and all this stuff. And I don't know why it's not coming up here. So very quickly, how far does Satan's kingdom extend? Well, we know that the white here would represent God's kingdom. We know that the black represents Satan's kingdom. Neither one of those are the issue. The question is, what about the gray area? All right? Does God's kingdom go partway into the middle? I say no. Satan's kingdom goes all the way to the very end there. I'm messing this thing up here. Goes all the way over here to the end, because a little leaveneth the whole lump. Are you with me? All right, let's move on. Number three, they say that we're going to use music as a tool for evangelism. You heard about Striper? This is Striper, an old picture of them. They say evangelism is a far worthier goal for Christian musicians than merely playing for and edifying the church. I could not disagree more, and the Bible disagrees with that, and in Colossians chapter 3. They say, well, I don't care what they say, to be honest with you. They are still around. They are considered, here's some of their, they still have a fan club. The black and yellow clad stalwarts of Striper have become beloved elder statesmen, not only of the Christian metal scene they helped found, but also of the late 80s glam metal. Did you ever hear of glam metal? You have.
Yes.
This is the first time I ever heard it. It's a subgenre of heavy metal that features pop influence techniques and rhythms. Now, let me say something about their appearance, all right? The Bible says, God looks in the heart. People say, well, it doesn't matter how you look on the outside. No, that's not true. Man looks on the outside, God looks on the heart. That's why the outside should reflect what's on the inside. And I'll tell you what, it does. Now, the Bible says in 1 Corinthians 11, doth not even nature itself teach you that it is a shame for a man to have long hair? These guys are in clear biblical violation of 1 Corinthians chapter 11. Maybe they've never read their Bibles. I don't know. This is their latest album. And notice, I've circled here, right up here, Isaiah 53:3, by his stripes we are healed. That is where they blasphemously take their name from, Striper. And this stuff absolutely makes me sick. What then is the biblical purpose of Christian music? Well, number one, it's not to entertain. That's why I discourage people from clapping after I do special music. Sometimes the pastors are the ones that encourage it, so I got to be careful. But I tell them this: when you go to a concert, you pay good money to hear a performance, and the only way you have of expressing your appreciation for the performer and his performance is by applauding. And all the attention rightly goes to the performer. Folks, in Christian music, it's not supposed to be about the performer. Like Amy Grant, when she comes on stage in front of 10,000 teens and they're screaming and wailing. And folks, that's ungodly. That's unbiblical. All the attention goes on her. Well, her music doesn't reflect much about the Lord anyway. But in truly Christian music, folks, the best thing you can do is say a good old-fashioned Methodist amen. We Baptists are afraid to say a Methodist amen. I don't know why, but the glory, otherwise when we clap, the attention is taken off of the vertical and put on the horizontal. All the attention goes on the person for their performance rather than to God for the ministry of music. So what is the purpose of Christian music? Number one, to exalt God. Whatsoever you do, do all to the glory of God. Everything we're to do is that. And contrary to what Stryper says, it is to edify believers. Colossians 3:16. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another with psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord, edifying one another. It is specifically to edify believers. In Isaiah 12, he is the source of our song. In Psalm 40, he is the subject of our song. He has put a new song in my mouth, even praise unto our God. Many shall see it and fear and shall trust in the Lord. He is also the subject of our song, the spirit of our song in Ephesians chapter 5, verses 18 and 19. Singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. Be not drunk with wine, we're in its excess, but be filled with the Spirit, singing and making melody in your hearts unto the Lord. He is the spirit of our song. And again, spirit-filled living will result in spirit-filled singing. And I really like the way you folks sing. You're almost as good as the people down in the islands. Man, they really belt it out.
Amen.
Now, the word spiritual, again, we mentioned this earlier, as opposed to carnal. Much of what goes for so-called worship music today is simply carnal music. It appeals to the flesh. It makes you want to tap your foot and get up and wiggle in the aisles and all this kind of nonsense. Spiritual music will minister to your spirit, not your feet. And then the idea of teaching, the idea there is to impart positive truth. We can learn a lot about doctrine by singing the great hymns. That's why a lot of times pastors will try to select hymns and songs for the song service that will go along with the theme of their message. If you're preaching on the love of God, man, there's a bunch of songs on that. One of the greatest ones is Love Divine, All Loves Excelling. And then, of course, there's an admonishment, teaching and admonishing one another with spiritual songs. Admonishing has the idea of warning in nature. You can never be blessed or have peace and sweet rest until all on the altar is laid. Why do you wait, dear brother? Why do you tarry so long? The Savior is waiting to give you a place in his glorified throng. Why not? Why not? Why not come to him now? Or another song that's a warning one is God's final call. Someday you'll hear God's final call to you. Boy, I've known some people. I know my father-in-law, I believe. We look back on his life and I realize I'm pretty sure when God's final call came to him. And he died at the age of 51, cursing God on his deathbed. I hope I never have to be in a death room like that again as long as I live. So there's an admonishment in the songs. And by the way, we've heard many stories coming out of places like Pacific Garden Mission, where Billy Sunday got converted. The music, they usually keep the doors open in the nice weather so people on the street can hear the music. And how many times have we heard it was the music that drew them in, sit in the back of the service, and come to know the Lord as their Savior that night? And then, of course, a secondary purpose of Christian music is to evangelize the lost, but it's not a primary one. And I will tell you this, folks, you will not win an unsaved person with worldly music. What's going to draw them is the difference. there's a marked difference, not only in what we sing, but the melodic line and the way we sing, if we're singing from the heart. And evidently, you all do pretty well at that. I've not heard any half-hearted singing here this week, and that's wonderful. Psalm 40, verses 1 to 3. Again, they saw the difference in David's life, and it caused them to turn to the Lord. Years ago, I was up in Alaska, and I met a young man, and he read my little book, the one that precedes the one that we have now, Gospel Music, Blessing or Blight. And he wanted to argue with me and debate me. Well, I'm not going to debate with you, but I'll talk with him. And so he had just gone to a Striper concert, which, by the way, averages in excess of 150 decibels of sound, which causes permanent hearing loss within seconds. Every kid that goes to one of their concerts comes away with less hearing than they went in. By the way, they threw black and yellow striped testaments and little Bibles out. And he told me, he said, they went to this concert, it was a three-hour concert, and they gave a gospel message, and 500 teens got saved. Isn't that wonderful? I said, frankly, that's terrible. He said, are you against people getting saved? I said, yeah, that's why I'm an evangelist, because I don't want to see anybody get saved. I said, let me ask you a question. I said, what was there in that concert that would produce conviction of sin? Well, nothing. It was entertainment. I said, then don't tell me 500 kids got saved. They didn't. They gave a little 5-minute sermon there, and they talk about you can have your rock music and let Jesus be Lord of your life. Folks, it is a satanic lie. 500 kids did not get saved. And I said, young man, you cannot feed the flesh for 3 hours and elicit a spiritual response. You might get an emotional response, but you'll not get a spiritual response when you're feeding the flesh for 3 hours. And that's very important to understand. And that leads me to the end of this session. I wish we could get that thing to show, but I'll have to do some work on that and see if I can figure out what I did wrong, because it had to be me. It can't be the computer. All right, do any of you have any questions you'd like to ask at this point? Or any comments? Maybe some of you have been saved out of this culture, and you have some observations from your own life you'd like to share. Yes, sir. Would you stand up and speak up so we can all hear up here? People are listening from Pennsylvania.
You said one of the hymns that mourn, and one that comes to mind is Yield Not to Temptation.
Yes. Yes, that's the one I was quoting from. Absolutely. Yield not to temptation, for yielding is sin. The temptation isn't sin, but the giving into it is. Yes.
When you're talking about the difference in the music drawing them in, my great-grandmother used to, every Saturday night, go down to the dance hall with her little girl in tow and feed her flesh. And one night, she went a different way, and she passed this little storefront where she heard this beautiful singing. And it was so different from what she heard down the street. Mm. She turned into a little mission, and she got saved.
Amen.
That night, and I wonder where I might be had she not heard
Amen.
That beautiful, godly music.
And Amen.
I just thank God.
I was directing the singing at a conference in Pennsylvania, and there's probably 500 or 600 people in the congregation, and there were some workers. We were using a convention center, and there were guys out there in the hallway who were painting, and they stopped, and I didn't know this till later. They came around and they stood there in the doorway. I'm watching these guys in their paint outfit. Standing there, and they made a comment to one of the ushers standing by, boy, we've never heard singing like this. Listen, folks, godly, biblical singing from the heart will have an impact on an unsaved person like you won't believe. But the rock music that they're used to is not going to do anything for them as far as drawing them into a place of conviction and ultimately to the Lord. Anything else? Okay, Pastor, I turn it back to you now. Sir?
You know, I was I just want to ask my people here for a minute. Has he said anything new to you when he talks about the principles and the Word of God, like separation and how you can't be two? Has he taught you anything new? Everything we have is in the Word of God, you know. I do appreciate it. I think you're right. You were telling me earlier, I think we're the same stripe.
We teach out of the same book.
Yeah, that's true. We've had people in here where they preach one thing and they sing another. We've had a lot of things. Let me just cut it to the chase. I've been looking for somebody who fits what we are to come in here and preach. How many of you would like to have him back?
I'm afraid to look. I'm afraid to look.
You got at least two. There's at least two, I see. And in my hand, it's going to be three.
366.
Turn to page 366, please. 366. Once you get that, if you'd like, stand, please. Together, they need to be married, and if we continue doing that, God will work and use it in our hearts and lives. But if that's not the way it is, you hinder the working of the Spirit. You know, we're talking in a church setting, but isn't that even more important in our personal lives to have that so God can work? All right, here's what's going to happen, and I'm not going to let you sit down. But anyway, for you who are visiting and do not know, we will do a quick breakdown. We'll move that table in the back and go back to the side, and then we'll set up. And so if you grab your stuff when I when I dismiss you, yes, ma'am. Yeah, well, sit down.
Oh, dear.
I always say I love people to keep me straight. Anyway, all right, could I have my ushers come forward? Listen, we passed the plate not to pressure you to give, but to give you an opportunity to be a blessing. We do know, and I told you, if you don't know, Brother Lynch has quite a bit of expenses to repair his RV. Have you heard any more about the air conditioner?
No, I haven't.
So right now it stands at?
34.
It stands at 34,000 for him, and that's his primary home, okay? So he travels around, and we need to help with that, but just, you know, keep it in mind. And just pray and ask God what he would have you give. So, all right, who's praying?
Dear Lord, thank you for this opportunity to gather together and learn about music. Please bless the gift and the giver this evening. Help it to be a blessing to Brother Lynch. In your name, amen.